Third Street in the back, and out to 4th Street where you came in. After the show, there's going to be a question and answer session. So if you'd like, you can stay for that. It's going to be streamed from Austin, Texas. So give them some time to set up for that. And sit back and relax and enjoy the show. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, presenting the colors today, the joint service color guard of the United States Central Command. Today's national performance will be followed by a flyover from B-171st Aviation Regiment, Florida, National Guard. And now, ladies and gentlemen, to honor America, Jane Christian will perform our national anthem.
Whose broad Mom says, what is this? Dad says, a picnic. Mom says, where are we? Dad says, in Texas. In Texas. Dad says, what day is it? I say, it's Sunday. Dad says, what time is it? I say, noon. Dad says, I'm hungry. I say, Mom knows. Dad says, I'm hungry. Mom says, pie.
To be alive is so, 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 so.
you get a job to put the rent down on my roof. I've had to have a roof to keep the rain from over my head. So I hired out a derrick where oil rained down instead. Symbols of the Oilers where I'll land. But first I needed lifting up by the Lord's own righteous hand. My pay and given to the Red Cross, and I didn't have a say. The only way to stop it was to make a stink and quit. Selfish little shit. People tried to keep me, the crew chief, my boss, but I was being guided by the sign of a blood red cross. I drove until I saw a field full of football players. They were knelt down by the goal, practicing their prayers. I thought I'd wait to see a game, but the stands were full of just one seat on the side of the bench, and I felt that bench is cold. The coach came over to where I sat and said I didn't belong. His instincts wrong. I used to play in grade school. I used to play for kicks. But this was junior college where they paid for scholarships. Only 1 week and I was on the team. 2 weeks I was starting. They paid for school and room and board and the new path I was on. I graduated and started to coach. Through decades we're gonna skip, but this is all to prove a point that I'm not the captain of this ship. Symbols too, and the occasion they're a part of is a lesson just for you. The Lord is there to guide you, maybe not to the NFL.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, master. improbable, the greater his fears.
I heard he was lonely. I heard he was tired.
I heard he was scared if he lost, he'd get fired. Can help you light shine
Listen up, last year
are you worried is out of gas?
Tell one when he's hurt and I'm wild.
welcome to stay if you like.
This was our opening weekend, so we're running through March 30th.
Good luck.
see anybody. I want to see Peter. Is she wearing hot? She was wearing hot dogs. What's that?
Can you hear us?
Yes!
Okay, great. We can hear you as well. So we're going to get started pretty soon. Just making sure that you guys hear us well and can see us.
Peter was taking something out.
You guys hear this man? You can hear this mic, correct? Wave at us if you can hear what I'm saying. Okay, great. Okay. We're going to check one other mic. Can you hear this mic?
So wave your hand if you can hear this mic.
Okay, awesome.
Thank you.
How's it going so far? Reflecting on the influence
influence that coaches have had on myself as a director in my work as well. And just the discipline and the loyalty and the teamwork, all the skills that I picked up in sports, and also the conditioning of the body that it takes, and the similarities between that, the performing arts and athletics. So I don't know, one day Bum's name just popped in my head. It was really random. And a warmest smile just crossed my face. I was born in Houston, Texas, and grew up during his Bum's heyday, his tenure with the Oilers, and luckily, my partner here, Peter, also experienced the Oilers, both from Houston, and the lovely Kirk Lynn, also from Texas, and got to enjoy the Oilers, and yeah, so we just had this great this team to get us started. We're like very excited about trying to bring this to life, and we discovered that Coach Phillips had written an autobiography in 2010, and after we read it, it really just seemed like the perfect vehicle to talk about all these teams that were on the line. That's really how it started.
That was Luke Leonard, who received and directed and designed the production. It would be great to hear. Can we hear from Kirk here? Yes? So,
yeah.
One time we went to five different places in Austin and got hamburgers from each place and told them we were doing a criticism on hamburgers in Austin, so they gave them to us all for free. So we do things like that, you know. We build little models of things and play with toys and just sort of get the juices flowing that way, you know. You know, it started out with the question of how are you going to represent a football game on stage in an opera without being ridiculous? And the answer to that was you can't. You can't do it. You have to be ridiculous. So that was sort of like my first problem that I tried to solve was how are we going to do these football games and how are they going to be represented? Luckily, Kirk writes, he's an amazing librettist, and he builds these big arcs, which are just beautiful, and puts a lot of the details in, and he also allows me to sort of shape the lyrics within that as the music starts. So for me, and I think for Kirk in the beginning, it was a lot about how are we gonna deal with these football games. But when we went and met Bum, we met him at a gas station outside of his ranch, and he rolls down his window. He's like, "Hi, I'm Coach Bum Phillips," you know, and "you wanna come to my house for some sandwiches? We got some Subway sandwiches and Fritos." And so we went to his house, and he served us Subway sandwiches and Fritos and Lay's potato chips, two kinds of potato chips, and a big thing of baked beans. And they just, he and Debbie, his wife, just opened their house to us, told us stories, let us just fire questions at him, never at all got frustrated. You know, he said, "You know I don't sing a lick, don't you?" You know, and then slowly as we were we're hanging out with him and listening to stories. His kids started coming over, his daughters started coming over to meet the guys who were making an opera about daddy, you know. And it was just such a warm thing to look at this man in the eye. He remembered things about players when he couldn't remember their names. He would say, Debbie, what was that guy's name? He had really big shoulders. He was about 6'4", 185 pounds. And then they would go, oh, that's Mike Barber or whatever. So he could remember the physical description of a person, the weight of a person, when he couldn't actually remember their name of the next player. And then, you know, we just talked about when your whole life's goal, and it seems so obvious what your life's goal is. You know, it was twice one game away from the Super Bowl. And it was a magic time. There was no reason. The Oilers were terrible. They were terrible. They were like, you know, 2-10, 4 years in a row previous to that. It just seemed so obvious that they were going to win. The whole spirit of the city was behind them. The Astrodome had just been built in Houston. The oil boom was going on. Everybody was just, Houston was kicking ass. I don't know how to say any different. And we have that whole country and western thing. It was like the 70s, you know, and everybody's dressing funky and rainbow wigs and stuff. And it just seemed obvious this was what the whole point of this man's life was to be, was to take this team to the Super Bowl, and he just didn't do it. So what do you do when the whole point of your life, you know, I'm a composer, what if one day I can't compose anymore? I was talking to Anlami about athletes. Athletes, he said, always live two different lives. They are athletes, and then at a certain point, due to injury or due to age or whatever, they have to redefine themselves as something else. And that's what this man had to do. You know, his whole life is very obviously going to be about winning the Super Bowl, but that's not what happened. And he had to redefine himself. And what he ended up redefining himself as is a missionary for prisoners and for deaf people. And he started his daughter started the first deaf school in South Texas. He did prison ministry as the whole later half of his life. And it just was amazing to meet somebody like that who just honestly talked about how, you know, redefining yourself in the later aspects of, in the later part of your life. And it all of a sudden became not about ridiculous football games, although that was a really fun part of it. But it became about a person, you know, and life, and how life is unexpected, and you never know what's going to happen, and how you define yourself and how other people see you is not always the way it ends up.
Tag on to that. The other question, why Bum Phillips? And you just said it's about being a human. We started realizing this was actually a story about faith, and not just religious faith or spiritual faith, but just faith, just belief, passion. You've said it before. The story's about a man's a life of passion, living a life of passion. And what we discovered about Bum is that his story is about faith and putting his faith into things that were going to reach a wide audience and do good for others. I've said it before at the memorial for Bum. Senator Dan Patrick said that Bum going to places like Angola, where 70% of the inmates were serving life sentences. He said nobody loved these men, but Bum did. Bum's love was unconditional. Bum loved first. And that's why we loved him. I think a theme for this show.
Perhaps our New York City students, as much as for the people who might be joining us from Greece or Zambia, that Houston in the 70s just as foreign. And I wonder whether there are any questions or reflections from the students. Are there any questions for the people who were involved in the show or thoughts about that?
I have a little notion that, well, Luke asked us to write an opera, but I was also excited for Peter to be able to write an opera. We had written musicals before. To write an opera, like you could, the music could lead rather than the book. Focus on his music.
From your perspective,
I'm like 3 seconds ago. It's so much fun.
For you, then, it was more of an artistic, artistically rather than what the material called for.
Yeah, I think just like the expansiveness of opera has a little, to me, more freedom and focus on the overall event than, you know, writing a musical.
Calling it a musical would have made it feel a little too much like a gimmick. And the other reason was that opera seems a little bigger to me. And Texas is large scale, and football is epic. And they just seemed, it seemed like a better fit, the size of it. And that was the main reason.
I wonder if any of the actors have any thoughts.
Well, as an opera, it has more passion, it has more connection to it, because it how would we say this? Everybody help me out. It gives you a more passionate depth to it. It's not like a musical where, and we all love musicals, and
yeah,
all of us have been in musicals. It's just that there's a easier kind of story going on. We're not talking about transformation. We're not talking about something large scale, as operas often do. They speak in terms of death or transition or major issues. People, you know, loss of children. Those are common themes in opera. Whereas in musicals, somebody's falling in love, somebody doesn't love somebody else. In other words, I agree with what Luke said, that operas tend to have much more passion, much more depth. Whereas in a musical, though very lovely and also has its own kind of depth, kind of stays more in the upper realms as opposed to the lower realms.
Anybody else want to speak to performing this as on the scale of an opera? Anybody? No? Okay.
So you mentioned that the playing the football game, a musical would lend itself more to the fact that it's an American game. This last Super Bowl, there was an opera singer who actually sang the national anthem. And that's the first, and that's the first one. I think that because we are bringing football, American football, to the stage, it was important for us to do it in what you'd probably call historical manner, and that would be operatic. So it's quite appropriate, and even though musical would lend itself to the game, I think that it is very appropriate to use opera, particularly because it is a first time project coming to stage.
Any of the other actors want to speak to that? Other questions? Any other questions? Yes.
As someone who's also from Houston, Texas, I was a little interested in why you chose to use so much cowboy imagery throughout the show.
Apparently there was Dallas cowboy imagery in the show.
No, like actual cowboy.
Oh, actual cowboy. Yeah. Okay. So question about why being about Houston Oilers, why were there lassos and horses?
That's a really easy answer. You want to answer it?
Sure. Going to Bum's house revealed a whole lot of things about him, you know, besides just like Subways and Frida's. His whole house was decorated in a Western style. He after his football career, he moved to the Saints and coached a couple of unsuccessful years at the Saints. And then he went home and started a ranch where he raised horses. His wife, Debbie, played by Allison here when she's got the rope around his neck or whatever, was a cutter,
yeah.
A horse cutter. Rodeo and cattle and actually being a cowboy were all parts of Bum's life. besides, you know, he wears his trademark cowboy hat. When you go in his house, he's got an entire wall of like 30 or 40 of those cowboy hats on the wall. And above the mantle of the fireplace is a spur collection. And I'm like hundreds of spurs, you know, ancient spurs that look, you know, like they're from Roman times or whatever, and then more modern ones, terrible ones that look like weapons that were made for him by prisoners at Angola special, like, you know, shivs or whatever. You know, he's just got this, everything's Western in his house. It's a ranch house, it's on a ranch. You know, the image of the cowboy with the hat tipped was actually on the gates entering into his property. We took that image straight from there. The other thing that I really love doesn't have a whole lot to do with cowboys, but it does have to do with Southwestern Christianity, is he had a crucifix made out of chili peppers in his bathroom, which I took a picture of and Facebooked immediately. I'm in Bum Phillips' bathroom, he's got this crucifix made out of chili peppers. So everything about him spoke to being a cowboy. And, you know, the music we play before and at intermission is from The Searchers. John Wayne was his favorite actor. You know, he loved the movie Alamo and The Searchers. So the cowboy was a huge part of who he was. It wasn't just an image. And that's another thing we realized when we met the man, is his image was his reality. Big time football, where we're marketing that it wasn't quite there yet for the NFL. So he really actually was a cowboy, like literally riding a horse on a ranch kind of cowboy.
Yeah, that's his book is called Bum Phillips, Cowboy Coach Christian. So he started as a cowboy. He was a real cowboy. That's what he did as a youngster. And the number three became a very important symbol throughout this opera. So we actually discussed his three identities throughout. Like, how do you represent, with the costume designer, Allison Hurrier, how do you represent Bum as a cowboy versus Bum as a coach versus Bum as a Christian? And so she tried to, accomplish that through her wardrobe. There were three announcers, three football games.
Three Jesuses.
Three Jesuses. I mean, there's a lot of different threes throughout, symbolically.
Other questions from the audience? Yes.
You had mentioned at the beginning that the only way to stage a performance about American football was to do it not seriously. But then afterwards you've said that doing an opera is deeper than doing a musical, and it's more serious. So how did you find that balance?
The absurdity of doing a performance about football and the seriousness of opera? Kirk, do you want to start with that? Uh-oh, we're not hearing you.
Decide what's serious and what's absurd. If you take it all seriously and you present it all in total sincerity, then you have interesting, you know, as we work on the music and we work with friends, you hear where people laugh and what they laugh at. And laughter is as often an expression of anxiety as it is an expression of, I don't know what else it is an expression of. But so it's fun to let these moments happen, and I feel greatly anxious. This is the first time I've seen the whole thing. And then I laugh. You know, we laugh some here, and you know, laugh some anxiety. And so the absurdness is relative to the audience, relative to each of us, what we take to be absurd. Does that make any sense?
Yeah, yes. Allison has a comment.
Well, I wanted to say that I come from a background of really just opera and the classics. I'm a Wagnerian singer, and you don't really get more dramatic than that. But with a story like this, to me, it was very important that the football scenes had humor, so that the scenes that were small between real people were more real. The scene with his daughter leaving, the scene between the two of us, they had a more eerie feeling to them, but they were more real than the scenes with the humor. I also wanted to add from earlier that in looking at doing this project, It's very different from anything I've ever done, and I kept saying, why do I keep getting drawn back to this? It's so completely different. And it was really, for me, that we make such a big deal about the people that win in our society. And, you know, I'm a mom, and I don't want my kids being raised to think that you only matter if you win. And the best people I've ever known were people that no one knew. My great-grandmother, who was a tailor, and I'm sorry I didn't get to meet Bum, but I did get to meet Debbie on the phone, and she's such a character, so much bigger than life, and I said, I want to be this woman. This woman is really strong, and this is really unusual, and I'd like to celebrate someone who dedicated their whole life to something and didn't make it the way we think of as making it. And you know, I've auditioned at the Met 5 times, and I haven't sung there yet. And maybe I won't. But this spoke to me in a very deep way that we need to look at who moved us because of what they committed themselves to and how they did it.
So we talk a lot about, you know, opera versus musical, and it just occurred to me, you know, I don't know why, just now. But, I mean, there are a lot of contemporary operas being performed and created these days, and they're not all, you know, Brunhilde with the horns.
Yeah.
So it depends a lot on what you, maybe, you know, people have a certain depiction of what opera is, and I think a lot of that has changed. There is American opera that is brand name American opera. It's not all just, you know, just don't forget that as well.
Yeah.
That this has its place. I think in the repertoire, it's just as valid, I think, and it doesn't matter that it changes and provokes different images and uses different things to kind of propel it. So
I saw Gertrude Stein smiling in the background.
That's all right.
Sorry. Yes.
Other. Did you want to answer? Okay. Yes.
Process of developing the design and working with technology as well as what was on stage.
I don't think we have any of
our
designers
design
here, but oftentimes I'll sketch ideas and then choose people that are really smarter than me and
That's a good lesson. Always work with people smarter than you.
And can make, you know, the ideas more beautiful. So it's really based in a lot of trust. But a lot of it's like original, just concept stuff, sketches. I do a lot of image research and just start to try to, you know, speak through images, speak visually to designers. Pieces for me. The great thing about this opera and any work that I'm interested in directing is when I read it, if I can't see it visually, it's a little bit more difficult for me to get into it and to want to direct it. So I loved this what these guys created because it had so much imagery from the get-go. I was immediately seeing pictures, and it really the difficult part is deciding which pictures to go with and editing. You know, because there's so many possibilities, and I'm really happy with what we came up with. But it really was like trusting the designers to build upon the initial ideas.
Other questions from the audience?
Yeah, I mean, I can hear all of your like genuine love for this person. I guess this is directed towards the director specifically, but how do you like come to terms with that when you have to then present something on stage that more than just those involved have to be able to connect with?
So how do you translate your own love for something?
Or maybe how do you step back from that a little bit in order to present it on stage?
Yeah, it's I could probably speak for a long time about that. We should get coffee. well, I think the first thing is that, know, when I was at UT, I got my MFA at UT, and I took this art class with Rebecca Brooks, who's retired now, as elements of art presentation. It's how you like interpret art and speak about art. And the first question on day one, she said, "What is art?"
There you go.
Yeah.
There it is. Right in front of us.
She said, "What is art?" She said, "Make a list of five personal criteria for what art is to you." The operative word was personal, and I didn't realize that until, you know, I don't know, a year later or months later, whatever. It dawned on me that that's really what I think she was asking us. It's like, what art is personal? So I feel like if you can start from a personal place, you're gonna be all right, and hopefully that will then transcend. I know a lot. Sometimes, you know, I'm not really interested in like therapeutic things where people get like really too personal. So yeah, it's I mean, in terms of this piece, that was on my mind. Like, you know, people don't know who this guy is. How do I sell it? How do I sell it to them? And I don't know, these guys can probably answer that question, but I can just say one thing is that when we met Bum, he gave me a VHS tape, a documentary made by NFL Films called Lost Treasures, and it was the first time they had ever done an episode on a coach, because they loved Bum Phillips. And it is just so moving and so inspirational. So really, I just showed people that film. Everybody was like, "Oh my God, this guy's awesome. Like, we have to, okay, we're in." But I don't know if anybody else has any more.
Well, kind of echoing back to what Debbie said, I think it's very important right now at this time with so many people getting so much hype. There's so much in the mainstream that looking at people, as she already stated, who we do not consider famous, we do not consider broad, big, mainstream type of people, but looking at the contribution and the things that they did from their heart and did things that really were quite big but are overlooked because they're not seductive to the media or culture in the same way. And I think that's becoming more and more what a lot of opera I know that I've been in and a lot of new projects where people are looking at people and what their accomplishments have been in a very, very different way. And I go back to Debbie's comment that life is not just about winning. Life is not just about becoming this big person that's, you know, got everything and is everything and will be everything. But it's really about that day-to-day, that totally internal part of ourselves that contributes, as all of us do, each and every day to every experience there is on the planet, and I think that's a really important concept and a really important message right now.
I'd love to add to that. So, yeah, it's like Bum could be you, Bum could be me, Bum could be anyone. And I also feel like there's a conversation happening in contemporary theater where people, yeah, they're building, they're making the mundane beautiful. Nature Theater of Oklahoma did that with Life and Times, and you know, it's verbatim type theater. And Young Jean, you know, you see her on Facebook, and she's, you know,
that's Young Jean.
Yeah, she's, you know, she's grilling, you know, her friends for questions because she's building, taking that content and putting it into her work. So it's coming from real life. So anyway, I think that's an interesting thing happening right now. Is how we make work is really interesting.
I'm interested in that from the cast as well as from the creators. That, as you say, Bum could be any of us, but Bum is also a historical figure.